RCEP has taken effect in the Philippines. The country's Trade Department gives its assurance the implementation of the regional agreement won't hurt local industries. Let's get more details from our correspondent, Jackie Pascual. Jackie.
Hi, good afternoon, Denise. You're right. The Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement takes into full effect starting today, June 2. Trade Secretary Alfredo Pascual and other officials of the Department of Trade and Industry just held a media briefing to talk about the benefits of RCEP and what it will do to the Philippine economy. Secretary Pascual said that the RCEP will form a crucial part of the Marcos administration's goal of boosting economic recovery and expansion. And of course, he also answered criticisms that the agricultural sector will be negatively affected. Secretary Pascual said that it's not the case. And in fact, the agriculture industry will be one of the most, will benefit positively in the RCEP. So the gains and benefits of RCEP, according to DTI, is that it can have zero or lower import tariff applied to Philippine exports. But more than just trade relations, the DTI officials mentioned that this will also have more stable market access for services by binding existing regulations. There will also be a preferential treatment for skilled Filipino professionals and business persons, improvement in financial service, boost regulatory cooperation on telecommunications and ICT services, and many more. So it's more than just improving the trade relations or the trade of the Philippines, but of course also benefiting services sector and as well as more investments in the Philippines. Secretary Pascual mentioned that RCEP is the world's largest free trade deal, as it accounts for 29% of world's trade, 29% of world's GDP, 33% of global inward foreign direct investments, and can benefit around 2.3 billion people here in the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, as well as the other free trade agreement countries such as Japan, China, South Korea, Australia, and New Zealand. And Denise, just to give a few examples of the benefits of RCEP, according to the DTI, for example, the garments industry in the Philippines will have improved because our garments trade with Korea currently, or before RCEP, was 5% tariff, but now it will possibly go down to zero. Same with fish canning, alcoholic beverages, coconut juice, chocolate, fruit cocktail and fruit juices, coffee, preserved pineapples, and many more. And they also insisted that other sensitive products will not be affected by RCEP, such as the agricultural products mentioned earlier, rice, sugar, and other commodities. So, Denise, they will still conduct more meetings, and they have also set a monitoring policy so that there won't be a surge of import products here in the Philippines. And that's the latest. Denise, back to you.
Jackie Pascual with that report. Thanks, Jackie. The Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, or RCEP, takes effect in the Philippines. This paves the way for lower import taxes for goods from at least 14 other countries. Despite opposition from some groups, the Philippine government said the deal will lower prices for consumers and attract more foreign investments into the country. For the Philippine Exporters Confederation, the deal is a win for all, including the agriculture sector.
The worry of the agriculture sector has been addressed, mainly because some of the products that they're saying, like rice, coconut, even onions, are excluded. The SME now can do even export by consolidation because they will be now very competitive. Everybody should be winning here.
RCEP is the world's largest free trade agreement, encompassing 15 countries that account for 31% of global GDP. President Marcos eyes technological solutions to curb corruption as he attends the National ICT Kickoff Ceremony. Our correspondent, Pia Gutierrez, has been monitoring that event, and she now joins us live with more details. Pia?
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on Friday noted the need for government to adopt new technologies to promote ease in government transactions, as well as ensure that the country remains competitive in the global market. The president made a statement as he led the launch of the Philippines' new GovPH Super App, a mobile application that will serve as a one-stop-shop platform for national and local government services. Through the app, a user can apply for clearances, certifications, and permits, file complaints or reports directly to government agencies, and even register their SIM cards. The app also allows the users to securely store their government-issued identification cards, such as their national ID and driver's licenses. The app is now available for download at the Google Play Store and App Store. Marcos Jr. says the Philippines has fallen behind in e-governance, and the government simply needs to catch up. This, as he noted, that many of the problems encountered by Filipinos are on the ease of doing business with government. He noted a survey that only 5% of an ordinary Filipino's online transactions concern the government. He says that while Filipinos now do most of their shopping or banking activities online, they still need to physically go to government offices and endure long lines to be able to transact with government. He also noted that ongoing digitalization efforts will significantly lessen corruption.
There is another part of this that is extremely important that we sometimes do not talk about, and that is the lessening of corruption. Because when you do not have to talk to a person at all, and for the entire process, there's no discretion that's being exercised at any point. It's either yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, one, two, is binary. That way, it simplifies it, so the process, especially for the citizen. And there is no discretion being exercised by anyone. Eh, kung di mo ako lagyan, hindi ko ipapaano ito. Hindi ko pa iipitin ko ito. Yung mga ganun.
Meanwhile, the president has certified as urgent the proposed Internet Transactions Bill. This is a measure which aims to promote and maintain robust e-commerce and build trust between online merchants and consumers through secure and reliable platforms. In his letter to Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri, the president cited the urgent need of the government to regulate electronic commerce transactions to strengthen consumer protection against fraud and other illicit activities and promote fair competition and security of business. The bill is currently pending second reading in the Senate. The House of Representatives had already approved its version back in December 2022. Denise?
Thanks, Pia. Former and current officials of the Light Rail Transit Authority are facing criminal and administrative charges over alleged anomalous maintenance contracts on the LRT Line 2 system. Included in the complaint filed by lawyer Jerry Francisco are current Administrator Hernando Cabrera and former Administrator Jeremy Regino, as well as officials of a South Korean firm. Francisco alleges the respondents conspired to defraud the government by using what he described as imaginary scenarios to conduct upgrade works. This, he says, led to the government losing about 274 million pesos in 301 days. One of the accused, Regino, denied the allegation, insisting he had no participation in the contract. The Philippine National Railways suspending services from Alabang in Muntinlupa City up to Calamba, Laguna to give way to the construction of another railway project. Our correspondent, Andrea Teguines, filed this report.
The Philippine National Railways is temporarily suspending its trips from its Alabang to Calamba stations and vice versa starting next month, July 2, to give way to the construction of the 873 billion peso north-south commuter railway system. That announcement was made by Transportation Undersecretary for Rails, Cesar Chavez, early this morning as he rode with commuters traveling through that route. An estimate of 800 passengers go through that route daily. That's why during the ride, Undersecretary Chavez assured them that the DOTR and the LTFRB are already preparing special permits for alternative modes of transportation such as jeepneys and buses for them to ride in the meantime. Despite the hassle, one of the commuters I talked to, she said that she's glad that a new train system will be built so that she can get to where she needs to go faster and in a more comfortable manner. But she's worried that ticket prices will become more expensive when that happens. We also got to talk to some informal settlers living near the train tracks in Calamba, and they're also worried about what's in store for them when the government makes them leave. The DOTR plans to finish relocating these families, which are about 7,000, from Calamba to Alabang before the year ends.
Sana maganda yung lilipatan. Kasi ang pera madaling mawala, di ba? Sana maawa naman sila, di ba? Kasi yan lang namin ang hanap buhay namin, tsaka bahay namin mawawala. Ganun talaga kasakit. Sana naman maawa sila. Dagdag sana, kahit may puhunan, di ba? Yan lang, ganun lang.
May nakita na ba kayong pwedeng, anong gagawin ni Goku?
Wala pa. Kaya makikipagsapalaran pa lang.
Bibigyan sila ng tinatawag na interim rental subsidy. Yung interim rental subsidy, yung mga ISF po dito, yung Calamba hanggang Alabang ay magkakaroon, depende ho, magkakaroon po ng 3,000, 5,000, 7,000, depende ho sa laki at kung saan sila i-relocate. Ang usapan dito ay in-city. So identified na natin kung saan sila, na-inspect na ng Asian Development Bank yung mga relocation sites. Principally, ang may obligasyon para sa livelihood nila ay ang local government unit. Ang obligasyon ng gobyerno, bahay, lupa.
This coming October, the DOTR and the PNR will also be temporarily stopping the operations of its stations from Alabang to Manila. Meanwhile, they plan to start the construction of the North-South Commuter Railway by June 30th. It will run from Clark, Pampanga to Calamba in Laguna, and it is expected to be fully operational by 2028 or after 5 years. And by that time, they expect travel time from Clark to Calamba to go down by 2 hours from the current travel time of 4 hours.
The Philippine Bureau of Animal Industry has endorsed the use of a Vietnam-made vaccine to counter African swine fever. Our correspondent Jervis Manahan tells us more about AVAC. Jervis, go ahead.
Yes, Denise, a vaccine for ASF is now awaiting approval at the Food and Drug Administration. The Bureau of Animal Industry has directed a vaccine brand to counter our problem on the African swine fever. They recommended the Vietnamese-manufactured AVAC for approval of the Food and Drug Administration, or FDA. Once the Certificate of Product Registration is issued, they will be importing the vaccine from Vietnam. It is a single-shot vaccine that will only be for healthy pigs aged 4 to 10 weeks old. This will not be mandatory, but hog raisers will be encouraged to vaccinate their swine population once the vaccine is commercially available. The BAE has not given us a fixed price yet, but the Department of Agriculture said they will ensure this will be affordable, especially for backyard raisers. An initial quota of 600,000 shots will be ordered once approved. This will be beneficial for the livestock industry as ASF continues to be a persistent problem in the country. The Bureau of Animal Industry says it's important to get approval as many swine stakeholders have already been waiting for it. And there is also a high demand for the vaccine globally. Right now, there are active ASF cases in 15 provinces in the Philippines, mostly at the Visayas region. Denise.
Thanks, Jervis.